You touched on many, many issues. I think that we'll pick them up later on in the discussion, but you mentioned just two things I want to highlight. Deconstructing jihadism. You mentioned that twice, but I also understand that you've made previous speeches emphasizing the need, the imperative to deconstruct jihadism. You know, in this region we have, in our country, over the last 13 years, a southern ethno-nationalist Malay Muslim insurgency that has claimed almost 7,000 lives now over the last 13 years. So something very close to home. Southeast Asia also is concerned about terrorism with the defeat of ISIS, the Islamic State, and the returning fighters, a few hundred of them, will come back to Philippines, Indonesia, Malaysia, and even Thailand. So we're very much concerned about that. You mentioned leadership, open societies, democracies tend to be opened, and the need to keep migration on the agenda and how to be open societies to accept migrants. I'll come back to some of these issues, much to digest, but let me first, let me now proceed to His Excellency Kasit Piromya from a Southeast Asian Thai perspective on the range of these issues.
Amrani, Dr. Thitinan, Excellencies, friends and colleagues. When I got the invitation from Dr. Thitinan, and he emailed me the subject matter, I was thinking initially, my first reaction was Dr. Thitinan a bit drunk over the New Year? Because how could you put three words, migration, terrorism, and democracy, in one sentence and ask someone to come and give a speech? But I have been putting a lot of thought over the days and so on, and said that, well, it does make sense, indeed. And I think Excellency Amrani has somewhat mentioned, but let me continue from where he started and left. First, with the word democracy. I think the lack of democracy and the failures of democracy is more or less are the causes of migration and to a certain extent radicalism and terrorism. And let me illustrate from the opposite side that with the successful story of democracy, then the word migration would not be the name of the game in any particular country, and terrorism or radicalism would not have a chance to emerge. And I just want to mention three countries, one very close by, and two countries in North Africa. The country in the Asia-Pacific region is Taiwan. I have visited Taiwan many times for meetings and so on. But during Christmas, a few days ago, the family decided, let's go to Taiwan for holidays. Because in my previous visits, I started to become more impressed with the political and economic development of Taiwan in an open society, in an open manner, which the minister was alluding to, that the development of Morocco must be two sides of the same coin, the political freedom and the economic freedom. And I think today Taiwan has achieved that. And its development is second to none compared to Japan, to South Korea, to Australia, New Zealand in the Asia-Pacific region. I deliberately failed to mention the word Singapore, not yet. But I think Taiwan is second to none compared to any medium-sized democratic countries in Europe. And once you go there, I think the sense of freedom, of openness, tolerance, inclusiveness somewhat permeates the whole society, and I would urge you to visit Taiwan. But when I mention Taiwan, I cannot fail to mention the mainland China, with its one-party system, economic development to become the second largest economy of the world without any political freedom. It's such a contrast. And why not all the developing countries go the way of Taiwan, which barely 30 years ago, 25 years ago, was a one-party system, the Kuomintang, or the party and the army is more or less one and the same. But I think by 1992, the leadership of the Kuomintang, the military leadership and so on, did decide that one has to go back to the constitution of Sun Yat-sen of the 1920s, which ended the emperorship of China, and wanted to move China along the democratic line. Then the Japanese occupation, the civil war, and the victory of communism. So the remnants of the Kuomintang forces moved to Taiwan, became a very autocratic, authoritarian country for 30, 40 years. But 20 years ago, about 1992, they had decided to turn to democracy. And now they have become a full-fledged democratic society in every sense of the word. A challenge to the mainland across the strait, and a challenge to all of us in the developing world. Then we look across the world into North Africa. Two countries stand very bright for our fellow developing countries to follow and to emulate. One, definitely the Kingdom of Morocco under constitutional monarchy. And next to Morocco, Tunisia, for whatever it is, the Islamic party was able to take a step back and compromise with the democratic forces, the bureaucracy and the army, and put the interests of Tunisia ahead and not the vested interests of any particular minorities, religious sects, or business groups, and so on. And if Taiwan could do it, Tunisia could do it, and Morocco could do it, why not Thailand? Why not Myanmar? Why not Vietnam, Laos, Malaysia, Singapore, Bangladesh, a cause for concern at this point in time? Even India and Pakistan and Nepal, Sri Lanka, countries in the region. So my point is that if democracy were to be able to take hold with its principle of inclusiveness, of tolerance, of fairness and justice, then the society could emerge and get out of its semi-failed state, banana republic type of situation. So my point is that once we become more democratic, then there will not be migration. There will not be terrorism. And Morocco no longer export labor. 30 years ago, Thailand export almost 1 million labor to the Middle East, to Israel, to Hong Kong, to Singapore, Malaysia, and Taiwan. But now the Thai labor abroad is no longer the factor because there are more opportunities at home. And the Thai laborers have become more skilled and no longer in the segment of unskilled labor. And it's imperative for whatever government in Thailand to increase the domestic investment and increase the domestic employment. I think we can go in that direction. But looking around, and into Thailand, we have about 5 million migrant workers in Thailand coming from Laos, Cambodia, Myanmar, and now from Vietnam. And small number coming from the Indian subcontinent. What is the problem? Because in Laos and Vietnam and Cambodia, more or less, is a very suppressive regime, or a suppressive regime. Myanmar has the possibility, but the leadership has no vision and the guts and the determination to settle the Rohingya's issue. What is 1 million out of about 50 million people? What is the problem of not being able to decide once and for all to give the citizenship to the 1 million Rohingyas? And what is so funny is that Burma or Myanmar is composed of minorities. How can the Shan, the Karens, the Wa, the Mons, and so on, could not have the empathy and the affinities towards the fellow Rohingyas who are also the minorities inside Myanmar? It's not the problem with Aung San Suu Kyi and the military leadership, but the various minority leaders must feel as part, must have that feeling for fellow Rohingyas and urge the central government to give the citizenship. So I think this is the question of the leadership come into fore. Then other types of leaderships either make democracy fail through their abuses of power and their adherence to the vested interest and by default to corruption or to corruptive practices. That are the causes that bring about the migration. So what we need is some sort of a first democracy should be the name of the game, and the example of Taiwan, Morocco, and Tunisia should be spread around the world by the United Nations, the UN Secretary General, and the UNSC, and so on. That's the first point, that I think we have to work together that democracy can be a success, and it can be good for everyone, and it could prevent migration and to a certain extent radicalism and terrorism. But on the question of terrorism, I would place the blame on all the religious leaders around the world, that they have not come forth in a forthright manner like Pope Francis. But I think he tried in his first few months, but he received no audiences from fellow religious leaders around the world to come on the stage with him and declare that to serve God, cutting heads of people is not acceptable. It's not in any of the religious teaching. Hatred is not, it's peace and loving and forgiveness. I think that's very important. And I have been urging all the Thai religious leaders to come out on the forefront. I am a bit disappointed with my fellow, my Muslim leaders here. They have not come out in force to be critical of the violence committed in the name of Islam religion. I think this is what we need to come out. I have attended as an observer the OIC meetings 2 times myself. And then that was almost 10 years ago, and there was a conclusion at the OIC meeting that Islam is a religion of peace. Then what happened to the Islamic religions around the world? Let's come out together in a very forthright, thoughtful manner to say that violence is not accepted, radicalism is not accepted, killing of people is not accepted. So I think this is what is needed. It's not only the political leadership, but at this point in time, the courage, the audacity of the religious leaders would be important. Put that aside. Now, my last point about migration. I think the UN Secretary General, the last one, has not been ineffective. And under his leadership for the past 8 years, the United Nations had an organization to help the world to promote peace. Development in particular has been a total failure. And by extension, the World Bank has not done its work to close the development gap, to bring about the poverty level. There has not been much of the news lately on the World Bank and the UNDP as the core of the consortium to provide development assistance to certain regions in Africa and to certain particular countries that need help. And the international consortium of the donor countries have not been forthcoming. I don't know what has been the lack of that enthusiasm, the lack of the sense of urgency to go and help. Only Chancellor Merkel did travel to 5 African countries for development problems. The French president went to Africa in order to provide French soldiers to suppress terrorism. I think he started at the wrong end of the things. The Francophone countries should not have to deal with development problem anymore if France were to take the lead and work closely with the European Commission of the EU, with the World Bank, and so on. So I think migration can be deterred if the international development bodies were to work together, to restart working together. That's one other point. My last point, I think this is for all the developed countries and major developing countries have to do what the Chinese have started to do, that birth control is no longer the order of the game. If you don't produce enough citizens, then there would be the need for migration. And if you become more developed, it's the pulling factor. And then you have socio-economic consequences. And then you have the like of Trump and Marie Pen and all the far-right leaders in most of the European countries at this point in time. More than 20 years ago, I was very much part and parcel of the comprehensive plan of action for the Vietnamese boat people. It was practically my baby, my child. And when we started to face the onslaught, the incoming of the Vietnamese boat people, the first French word that my fellow colleagues from the United States, Canada, Australia in particular, New Zealand, and all of the European countries, France, United Kingdom, the first word that I learned about refugee was the French word non-refoulement, no rollback. So we have to accept 1 million Vietnamese boat people on that principle. At the same time, we have to take care of the Burmese refugees, almost 1 million. Then later, we have another 1 million or 2 of the Cambodian fleeing the Khmer Rouge. On top of that, we have the Laotians and the Hmongs, the minorities, and so on. Thailand was the example of the country that does not misbehave towards the international obligation. And we were successful. But we were successful not alone. Because UNHCR was our friends. IOM, International Organization for Migration, was our friends. And the international community did contribute in terms of personnel and money. So the word non-refoulement was linked to the word temporary transit and to the word final resettlement in third countries and to the fourth word repatriation back to the country of origin. Why can't President Trump has that sense of direction? And why can't all the European leaders of today? And why cannot the new UN Secretary General, who was the director of UNHCR for a long, long time, the former Portuguese Prime Minister? I think we did have the successful stories on migration, on refugees, on displaced person. I think we have to relook at that achievements of the past. We do have the successful story of Morocco, Tunisia, and Taiwan. Then democracy can move forward. And one last point. We cannot repeat forced democracy on any particular country. I think the minister did mention. I do agree fully. Democracy must come from the inner desire of the people to be free. It doesn't need the urge, the instigation, and the interference from the outside forces. I think people have enough intelligence to make a distinction between Taiwan and mainland China, Hong Kong and Singapore for that matter, and so on. Thank you very much.
As you can see, Mr. Kasit has he has certain views, he has positions. He doesn't just keep an empty talk. That's why we like to have him here as often as we can. Now the floor is open. I mean, a lot of both speakers, I think, have covered the gamut of issues and themes that challenge us. We can see that migration is not really the root cause of terrorism, and that democracies tend to be open societies to migration. Both speakers, the former ministers, also talked about the role of leadership, I think, repeatedly. And leadership is hard to come by these days because it can be very costly politically. But nevertheless, in key places, in countries that have moved ahead, the role of leadership has been critical, instrumental, and indispensable. Also, we heard a lot about the need for compromise, inclusiveness. I think without inclusiveness, you will have alienation, estrangement, and that will lead to all kinds of problems. So. Many issues out in the open. The floor is open. If you want to have any questions or comments, please raise your hand. We have another 15, 20 minutes or so.
First of all, congratulations. Well, my question is concerns where you said Morocco coming back to the African Union. So, I mean, we're discussing migration, terrorism, democracy. So I believe Habas is going to have major challenges once again in Addis Ababa. The question is, but there is also a pending question in Morocco. So how can you face maybe all those challenges within the continent and within to try to solve with the dialogue? Because I mean, Morocco has always been considered a very balanced country, very advanced in many areas. The code famille, the family code that you changed, also the sub-Saharan immigration. So we have so much to offer and to give. That's very good experiences. But at the same time, although it's going to be a challenge for sure, because you have to think about the whole continent and all those issues are there. Also, there is all, maybe for Haba a major challenge to how is going to improve this dialogue that have always favored with the Sahara question.
Thank you very much for your question. Of course, dialogue, stability and security are the major dimensions of the Moroccan foreign policy. And even when we left the African Union, we have continued to strengthen the relations with Africa. We are the major contributor and peacekeeping force in Africa. We are the second major investor in Africa today. And we believe that Africa is the continent of the future, and which was the continent of that will grow for more than two digits. And we have been having a dialogue with our European partners to work on Africa, because the future today, context in Europe, division in Europe, the certainties in the Mediterranean, we need to work in Africa where there is a lot of possibilities of growth. As far as your question about the, I don't think something would change. Now we are coming back to our family as an institution, but as far as our African policy will continue to work, you know, because we understood today that is job creation, promotion of growth are essential for stability and peace. As far as the Sahara issue you were talking, we'll continue in the process of dialogue in the UN within reaching a compromise solution based on the realism and pragmatism and the spirit of compromise, which is essential. We'll continue to work because the solution should be found within this dialogue, within respect of some parameters that are essential, and these parameters are spirit of compromise to reach mutual agreed political solution, but also the respect of the integrity of the states. Because if we come and start cutting this knot, it's not a solution. Today, there is no future for failed states. Failed state will fall in, not only in everywhere, not in Africa. Today, we need to follow your example of regional integration. It is in the Maghreb. And we follow your example in Latin America, Bolivia, Chile, Brazil, Argentina, and so on. You have tried to overcome your political differences, building up regional integration. For me, Mercosur was a very important, you know, as a first step, and Comunidad Andina, and now UNASUR. So we need to work on regional integration, on dialogue, to solve the problems, and to build up coherent societies and respond essentially to the generation, young generation, expectation in as far as job creation. Political issues we can solve, you know. Always are discrepancias in todo el mundo. But I think, thank you for your question.
Thank you very much. This year, you know, Morocco just rejoined the African Union. This year for us, you know, we used to compare ASEAN to the European Union. But in recent years, much less so. I don't have any more students doing term papers on EU-ASEAN. But African Union, in fact, we haven't much done comparisons with or learned from. Minister Kasit, so 50th anniversary of ASEAN this year. How do you think ASEAN is doing, and what ASEAN could learn to perhaps draw from other regional organizations for greater integration, more effectiveness?
I wrote an article two or three weeks ago, and I have been urging the 10 ASEAN leaders to meet as frequent, as often as possible. Unless and until they see each other, knowing each other's personalities and so on, then ideas would crop up on how to push ASEAN further. Because the meetings of the ASEAN leaders have been a sort of a formality, and they decided on what the bureaucrats have already prepared. But what has been lacking, which the minister just mentioned, the word global vision, that has been totally lacking. And so in that sense, you don't know what are the thinkings of the 10 ASEAN leaders, where are they going to lead, and so on. So they have to meet first. They have to be on a personal, you know, friend basis and so on. And by meeting one another, then one could re-examine what are the internal problems, what are the challenges in Asia Pacific region around Southeast Asia, and how are we going to cope with Trump, or with Brexit and so on, or with Turkey, all of these needs. And then we should have more role in the definite creation of the Palestinian nation state. Thank you.
My name is Patrick Omot. I'm the ambassador for Kenya. Let me thank both speakers His Excellency Amrani and His Excellency former ambassador for their very, insightful remarks. I mean, this is a topic so important for us, especially in Africa, because we face all those challenges, especially the sub-region that I come from, Kenya, the so-called Horn of Africa, which has become a hotbed of terrorism in the recent past. I also want to take this opportunity to welcome back Morocco, because we know Morocco yesterday rejoined the African Union. Morocco is a country so important to have been out of the African Union. Morocco is a pillar of stability. It's a good lesson in democracy and economic development. And we think that the return of democracy will make the African Union richer and will enable us to sort out our problems much better. But just to go back to the points raised, I got the impression that Ambassador, the view that democracy is the antidote to terrorism because it provides outlets for people's grievances. Yes, I think we believe that. We believe that democracy probably is the best antidote to terrorism. And in fact, in our view in Kenya, we think the most insidious danger presented to democracy by terrorism occurs when democracy self-harm themselves by trying to deliver themselves security by deeply misguided means, by tampering with the civil liberties, like what is happening with our big friend across the Atlantic. So I think the challenge is to have a multifaceted approach. And I want to concur with what His Excellency Amrani said, that I think there's no one cap, fits solution. There's no one cap that fits the head. I think we need to take a multifaceted approach and probably look at specificities of every country. In our region, for instance, there's a terrible mix, of issues the terrorists an upper hand. I would say Kenya today is probably one of the most democratic. I mean, we have a vibrant media. We have a very elaborate Bill of Rights that provides all manner of freedoms. But then the question we're asking ourselves is, how do we deal with what is happening in our country? Do we roll back the gains that we've made over the years? Or what is the answer? So I think it's a big debate. It's a big issue. And I'm happy that you've opened discussions on this matter, and probably we'll keep on talking about it so that we can come up with a better solution to how to deal, how to challenge the issues of terrorism, other than coming up with responses that may not quite be helpful. Thank you.
It's not good to use American expression today, but I think one expression in Manhattan, New York says, one of the shops, he said, one size fits all. It's not possible anymore. You cannot, so we need to have a comprehensive approach, a holistic approach, as you have said. Today, I think one country alone cannot fight this target of terrorism. Two, democracy is essential, because when there is frustration, when there's lack of freedom, when there is a poverty, when there is a exclusion, this is the fragile territory for extremism, and we have noticed this in our countries. So you need to have a stable country, you need to have possibilities of work, you need to have transparent instruments, and you need to have communication strategy. Today, the big issue, and I'm talking on behalf of the countries who are facing this issue of terrorism. There's this poverty, yes, it's true. There's poor of security too, but we need to work on the mind of the people. Because today, these people have hijacked Islam to promote a culture of hate. I want to emphasize today that this Islamic or radicalist or violent has nothing to do with Islam. Islam never has asked people to kill others. Essential. This is the interpretation of extremists and radicals. That's why we need to work on the narratives. That's why we need to have the leaders on board, religious Muslim leaders, to work on the interpretation of the text and the context. And that's why we need communication strategies to fight them. That's why we Morocco, we believe, and we have started a long time ago, through democratization, through the formation train of imams, people who give the speeches, because whatever you want, religion is important in our countries, so you have to deal with it. And religion could be an instrument of development, could be an instrument of democracy. And today, we all share the same values, international human rights and so on. And today, Islam is compatible with democracy, it's compatible with human rights. Only the people, the radicalized, they try to sell. So that this is the fight. The fight is against the radicalized, the extremists, Salafists. And this we have to use the same tools to combat these people. Tools as far as communication strategies, as far as people, young, reform of education is essential. And if we don't reform our books in our Arabic Muslim world, we will nowhere. And if we don't change the discourse of hate of the other, this is something we have to work on. And democracy is essential.
Thank you. This view is consonant with our neighborhood in Southeast Asia. I want to just ask the Minister Kasit, you know, until recent years, and well, even today, Indonesia is the largest Muslim country in the world, right? 255 million, and it's been viewed as a modern, secularized Islamic nation of great diversity, lots of islands, and is also a bastion of democracy now in Southeast Asia. But there has been some worrying reversals in some areas, especially in Malaysia. Malaysia recently more, I think we've seen some influence of the Islamist in Malaysian politics, and I think even us in Thailand, we're concerned about this influence spreading in southern Thailand. Minister Kasit, would you be concerned going forward in the near future? Would Southeast Asia still be able to handle this challenge?
On Malaysia, I think Najib is playing dirty. I don't know any of the Malaysian embassy people here, but sorry. I have said this in Kuala Lumpur, you know, that he cannot try to win and keep hold to power by playing the Islamic card to deny any votes on the part of the non-Muslim opposition, the Democratic Party, Anwar Ibrahim's party and so on, and try to sort of have the tacit alliance with PAS, the Islamic Party of Malaysia. I think he's playing dirty, and it's going to be destructive for Malaysia as a whole. That's the first point. I think UMNO should avoid using the Islam factor into the politicking and the campaigning. I hope he will have enough senses and people around him, highly educated. A lot of them went to Oxford, Cambridge, and Harvard, and Yale. I hope that they will partake some of that learning and try to modify and moderate the leadership of UMNO. That's the first point. Second, I think the president of Indonesia have to be more forthcoming. He has been elected as at least two major cities of Indonesia and subsequently as president. So he came through the democratic route successfully, and he must not allow any parochial, nationalistic, cum Islamist to have a foothold in Indonesia ever. He has to recourse to the five principles of Pancasila, of tolerance, of multiculturalism and coexistence and so on. I think that should be the norm and the practice for Indonesia for the years to come, and that the president must come out together with Megawati, you know, and the ulama, and the Mohammedan, other socio-political religious group and so on, to deter any extremism to really emerge onto the political scene of Indonesia. I think the case in point is the, I think, Chinese-Indonesian mayor of Jakarta. A few words in there, then so much of the outcry, and then the government has been sitting tight. I think that is not that's not welcome at all. So the leadership is very important. Indonesia has been successful in being a secular state. It should continue, and it would be better to have the secular state under democracy and not under the military rule of Suharto of 30 years. and it could be the example for other countries. Thank you.
I'm Emina Hajiabdic from the Swiss Development Agency in Laos, visiting the Swiss Embassy currently in Bangkok. Thank you, first of all, for two very inspiring speeches. And I would like to pick up on what you, the very first thing you said, Mr. Kasit, that the lack of democracy or failed democracies or failures of democracy are some of the root causes for migration. And that if we were only to spread more democracy, we would perhaps make migration preventable. Now, looking at my home country, which is Switzerland, most of our migrants come from democratic countries in our neighborhood. So I wonder, are we not spreading a false hope and maybe something dangerous if we say that if we were to have more democracy, we'd have no or less migration? Please contradict if you want.
My name is Kabiru Bala. I'm with the Nigerian Embassy here in Bangkok. What I want to highlight is the need for a communication strategy, which I think the minister from Morocco highlighted. Now, if you listen to the news, and you read newspapers, what you hear and what you read is migration. People are moving from Africa to Europe. And that these migrants are possibly about to submerge Europe. As if Europe is the center stage of this migration. But I think Europe is not the center of this migration. There are hosts of migrants in the world that are more than Europe. But they are not blowing their trumpet. They are hosting refugees from different parts of the world, but they are not popularizing what they have done or what they are doing for refugees. Now, we have learned one lesson from this lecture, that Thailand has done brilliantly well hosting refugees from different parts of this sub-region. And yet, I only got to know about this today. It's not being popularized outside, so people do not know. I think we need to find a way of enlightening the world that yes, these are some of the things that we are doing. And these ones that are saying maybe they are the center stage of this refugee crisis, they are not saying the correct thing. So we need to develop a new communication strategy in order to enlighten the world about this migration. Thank you.
Thank you for that very informative session. I'm from the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. My question is to His Excellency Amrani. You have highlighted throughout your speech about working together. My question on terrorism is that how do you go about working together when at the moment you can't even have one definition on terrorism? You have 193 countries on the UN arguing just about definition of terrorism. Then how can we work together to combat or to tackle this issue collectively? Thank you.
Okay, I think maybe perhaps one question each. Minister Kasit, is democracy, more democracy enough to prevent migration, or are there other enabling factors?
I think related to the question from the colleague from Switzerland, I think it's the question of supply and demand. Because Switzerland very low birth rate, and I think more than 15% of your population at the moment are foreigners. Just not enough people to work in Switzerland for the Swiss economy. So you need the foreign labor. And the closest that you have is from Eastern and Central Europe and around. And you get the rich ones from Western Europe to put your money there, their money there, and pay lower tax. Everyone is happy. But I think I still believe in the openness, because once people are able to speak to one another, the recourse to extremism will be minimized. And I said this, I have said it many times, that we have to sit down and really speak to the leaders of the separatists in the South. I have also suggested, I will have an article next week to say that the military government have to have a delegation to speak to Khun Thaksin. We got to speak to one another. And I think Colombia has shown the way. I think Nepal has shown the way. Sri Lanka has shown the way. At the end of the day, you got to speak to your opposite side, which you call your enemy. Otherwise, the society cannot move forward. And to do that, you need a democratic setting, because authoritarian, totalitarian would not speak to the so-called political enemies. Only suppression, imprisonment, and series of rules, and so on, and threat, and the what you call atmosphere that is permeated with fear element, and so on. Thank you.
Would you say that the same could be said for the southern Malay Muslim insurgency and the need for dialogue and
yes.
peace?
Yes. Yes. Definitely. Definitely. You have to speak to them. I have to find out who are they, and so on. And I do not even one more point to have Malaysia as in the go-between mediator, because Malaysia is part of the solution. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Amrani. You mentioned about narratives and a need to win the narratives fight. I think this issue about the terrorism, how it's seen in the eye of the beholder. Some people say terrorism is this, and the saying, right? Freedom fighters are terrorists. Terrorists are freedom fighters, depending on who you are. So. What would you say to that?
Listen, I will be brief. I will tackle two issues at the same time. We need a comprehensive approach, both to fight terrorism and illegal migration. We need to work together, yes? Through security, exchange of information, sometimes military intervention, but this is not enough. In the case of migration, for example, it is an issue of shared responsibility. And when I'm talking about working together, means all the countries of the chain of migration, the countries of origin, the countries of transit, and the country of destination. So no wall can prevent migration from moving. They can be, we have in the Mediterranean, we have implemented with Spain joint actions to prevent illegal migration. That didn't work. We had to work on communication, but we need also to do our homework, implement democracy, create jobs. Because at the end of the day, we need to respond to the expectations of our young generation as far as job creation. And if we don't have projects, like the one we're working now with Nigeria on the gas pipe from Nigeria to Europe. This will, this is an important project, because it will create jobs, it will bring stability, it will, 10 countries will work together. This is something that we have to work together. So building confidence, building measures, essential. And then you need to create some hope for the future, as far as terrorism. And no, the big issue as terrorism today, it's not anymore a problem of definition. We had this debate 10 years ago at the Security Council. We need to work our heads. Today, everybody agrees that Daesh, ISIS, it's a threat that is targeting Asia, Africa, Europe, America, everywhere. We are dismantling cells every you can imagine on a daily basis in London, Paris, Brussels, Rabat, Casablanca, Nigeria, Boko Haram. These guys, these bad guys, have a strategy, have a common vision. Boko Haram, Al-Qaeda, ISIS, they have the same vision. So we need to fight them in their territory with the same tools, fight them through the media, through internet, to deal with measures using men and women. And we have to also do our own homework as Muslim Arab countries. And as Minister was saying earlier, we need the leadership to combat this through deconstruction of the jihadist narrative, but not only deconstructing, but also proposing alternative narrative. This, I think, is a key issue. We are working on it, you know, today in Morocco. We are training imams in Africa. We are training imams in France. This was a request of the French president to because, as I told you, Islam has been hijacked by minority, and they're trying to use it to harm everybody. So we need, this is something, it's a priority. I don't think there's any difference at the level of the UN. Everybody today considers this extremist, violent, radical movement as a threat for our security.
Thank you very much, Mr. Amrani. We're running out of time, so I just want to wrap up. I mean, I think that we've covered all sorts of issues, a wide range, a whole gamut. Suffice it to say that, you know, whatever the winning narrative will have to include leadership. I think that this is a clear, protrusive theme today. Compromise from within. So, you know, the winning narrative we need would be leadership, collective action, you mentioned, compromises within. And I think that the democracy imperative is still critical to winning the narrative. So please join me in thanking our inspiring speakers today, Minister Amrani from Morocco and Minister Kasit Piromya from Thailand. Thank you for joining us. Our next event, as I mentioned, will be Friday morning on President Donald J. Trump. The meanings and consequences for Southeast Asia and Thailand. Thank you.